Welcome back, everybody. In this next chapter of our course, we're going to start talking about some basic concepts of probability. I know we've talked a little bit about probability already, but we need to start talking about probability in a slightly different way, because the language of inferential statistics is built upon probability, and we just need to make sure that we know some basics. I'll try to keep this video relatively brief. After I talk about what we know about probability already, all I really want to do at that point is briefly review three different viewpoints, three different perspectives of probability. Let's quickly review what we already know. Probabilities range from 0 to 1, inclusive. Remember, a probability of 0 means something is not going to happen. A probability of 1 means something is a certainty. We usually talk about probabilities in terms of percentages. So we might say there's a 0% chance that something's going to happen. That means it can't happen. It's not going to happen. Or we might say there's a 100% chance that something is going to happen. That means it's a certainty. That would be equivalent to a probability of 1. Of course, most other probabilities that exist in the world are somewhere in the middle, between 0 and 1. We also learned something very interesting, that area equals probability. And specifically when we're looking at normal distributions. And that's why that standard normal table really turned out to be our friend. With the standard normal table, we can measure anything that is normally distributed, transform those measurements into z-scores, and then very easily compute probabilities based on that data. In essence, those z-scores provided a bridge between our data and computing probabilities very easily about our data falling in any particular range. We've also talked just a little bit about what it means to have statistically significant results. And in general, what it basically means is that we have effectively ruled out sampling error as an explanation for our results. In other words, the results that we have are not likely due to chance. Well, keep this in mind. Every time I say that word likely, I'm talking about likelihood, which is really just another term for probability. So, because inferential statistics is so intertwined with probability, we just need to make sure we understand it from several different angles. And as I mentioned at the bottom of that page, a good general understanding of probability will help you lose weight, think more clearly, and attract new friends. Those things, of course, are true. All right, let's just spend a little bit of time here talking about three different viewpoints, three different perspectives of probability. And then in future videos, we'll talk at much greater length about one of these perspectives in particular. In my opinion, the simplest type of probability to understand is probability based on the subjective view. Here we're really just talking about probabilities that are based on a person's experience or intuition. So, for example, I'm from Cleveland. Born and raised. And although I don't follow the Browns as closely as some of my friends do, I've been a fan long enough to understand that organization pretty well. And based on my lifetime experience with that team, based on my intuition, based on the information I have, I believe it is impossible for them to win a Super Bowl. So, in other words, I think the probability of the Browns winning a Super Bowl in the next couple years is zero. Do you see how that's just a subjective estimate of a probability for some type of an event? It's not something that we can compute. It's not something that I computed in my head. It's really just some type of hypothesis I have about this particular team. So the subjective view of probability is really very interesting, but there's not much we can do to compute examples, so we really won't talk much more about it. Let's talk next about the frequentist view. Here we're talking about computing probabilities based on prior observations. So essentially, this is a way of computing probabilities based on past data. You can probably see already that the frequentist view is an improvement upon the subjective view because here we're calculating the probability of an event based on having some information, based on past data. Let me give you an example. Every single day that I've been alive, the sun has risen in the morning. And every single day that my parents have been alive, the sun has risen in the morning. In fact, every single day that every single one of us throughout history has been alive, the sun has risen in the morning. Now, I know the sun doesn't actually rise. Let's not overthink this. In the morning, we perceive that the sun rises up above us. That has happened every single day. We have past data on this event. So, if I need to compute the probability that the sun is going to rise tomorrow morning, I can compute that probability based on all that past data. That is an example of probability from a frequentist view. So really, as you're trying to tease these three apart, the key thing about the frequentist view is that we have some type of past data, some past information from which we can compute a probability upon. And I'll tell you, there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with estimating the probability of some future event based on having some good past data. That said, there's another viewpoint of probability that we call the analytic perspective. This is a really good way to compute probability as well, but it is not based on past data. Instead, based on the analytic view, we actually compute probabilities based on assumptions that all outcomes regarding some event are equally likely to occur. Let's go through a simple example of that so you can see what I mean, and so you can see that the analytic view differs in important ways from the frequentist view. Imagine this coin right here. Imagine that I ask you to compute the probability that when we flip that coin, it's going to end up being a heads as opposed to a tails. If you were a strong supporter of the frequentist view, you would start flipping that coin. One after another, after another, after another, you would start flipping that coin. In other words, you would start collecting data. So you might find you've got heads, then tails, then a heads, then another heads, then another head, then tails, then head, then tails, then heads, then tails, and you're plotting all this information. And then in the end, you compute for me the proportion of times that that coin landed heads. And then you use that value to estimate the probability that that coin is going to turn out heads in a future coin flip. I hope that you're seeing that seems like a lot of work when there's another alternative way to do it that makes a lot of sense. And it's that analytic view of probability that is the alternative that makes a lot of sense. And that's because coins are manufactured so that they're essentially equally weighted, so that they're just as likely to come up heads as they are tails. In other words, all outcomes, heads or tails, are equally likely to occur. Well, if all outcomes are equally likely to occur, and in this case there are actually just two outcomes overall, then the probability of any one outcome must be 1/2, or 0.50, or 50%. So in this case, we can just make a reasonable assumption about that coin, that both sides are equally likely to come up, and then very easily we can figure out that the probability of flipping that coin and having it turn out heads is 0.50 or 50%. So I hope you agree with me that the analytic view is much more fun than the other two. And that's the view that we're going to focus on in the remaining lectures on probability. The next time we get together, I'll show you three simple steps for computing basic probabilities. I'll see you in that video. In the meantime, be safe.